So first, this presentation will give a short overview, just to switch. Oh, okay. Let me try if it works. Okay, so first some background. So I work at Ericsson Nikola Tesla, which is a Croatian company that is part of the Ericsson group, but it's not fully owned by Ericsson, so we have some independence. It's not really well known as a Java development company, but we have somewhere above 200 Java developers, so it's quite a large community. And projects which are being developed are also very diverse. So we have eHealth, I think, is the one that's most commonly known. We also have some governmental projects with Cadastre, but there's also some Java development in IPTV and some other areas. And I work in a small research and innovations department, which has wide range of projects, and SKS is one of them. And we're also hiring, so if you'd like to join us, we'll be more than happy to have you. Okay, so about the SKS, that's the EU FP7 project. So that was initiated 2.5 years ago. So we have one year to go, or to say less than a year. So it will be done in 8 months. So we're in the final stage, and more or less what we're trying to do now is show what we've been doing for the past 2.5 years, and gather a community around the tools and platforms which were developed in SKS. So what is SKS? So the full name is Scaffolding Scalable Software Services. So that's not really understandable. So I have a pronunciation guide. So that's actually prototyping cloud web services. And that means that SKS aims to quickly prototype REST services that can be run in the cloud. So here you have your typical software development cycle. So we may be mistesting here, but okay, it will survive. So we start from an idea, then we have some requirements written down usually or spoken between the team. Then those requirements are expanded into more detailed specifications. So we have some more technical details. Then we go into more technical details and start the design phase. So we add some architecture, some platform specific information. And then we have the development phase, which usually has first step is to develop a prototype, which is then usually thrown away, and so something better is then developed. So this is how it usually works, and you have a small loop here, but this can be a really big loop. So this can span years, or it can span weeks if you're in some agile mode or scrum mode or something like this. So what SKS wants to do is to help you first reuse existing artifacts. So to help you find whatever you can online to put into your prototype, and then to remove the design phase and specification phase. So to go directly from requirements to the prototype. It sounds a bit science fiction. Okay, so what we have made in this past 2.5 years, we have the ability to generate RESTful web services out of requirements. So you can write requirements in English text. So in English sentences, and out of those you will get RESTful web services with some nice features. So we have authentication. A basic authentication is built in, so you can spend on top of this to provide whatever you want. We also working to add the ABAC authorization, so some finer grain control of what the user can do. And we have a built-in database, so all data can be persisted in a database and is done automatically by the SKS engine. And we also have search across the database. So if you want to find anything in your text that your clients will store in a database, this is also built in. And finally, we can also call external web services. So if you want to have a connection between your web service and some already existing web service. So for instance, to get your IP address converted into country and then into currency, you can do this also automatically. So we can mash up web services which you can find online. And when you're done with this, you'll get a Maven Java project. So it's a JAX REST web service that you can compile and deploy. So it's fairly simple. How does it work? So we have a few simple steps on the dashboard in SKS Tools. It's built in Eclipse. So I hope at least few of you will know what to work how to work with Eclipse. So we have four steps. We have the design phase, the mashup phase, the code generation phase, and then the run phase. So the design phase, you just create requirements which describe how your service has defined its resources and their properties. And you can also define storyboards, which are some simple form of workflows. So it has steps, and it has conditions, and has some properties which can be transferred between those steps. So these are your requirements. You can also reuse existing services, so that's called a mashup, I believe. So we can create a mashup based on the workflow. So we can state that for your composite web service, you want to call something that will get an IP address of the client. Then the next step will be to convert that IP address into a country name, and then finally, you want to find out the currency which is valid for a country. And then you can also add a step to convert from your local currency, for instance, kuna, into the destination currency of your clients. So it's all transparent to you. So we can define such mashups, and you can then generate also Maven code for that, so Maven artifacts for that. So you'll get out a Java web service that will do all those steps for you automatically also. So when you're done, you can just click generate code and get yourself a running web service. If you click on run, you can also deploy it on our cloud platform or on any other web platform that you choose. So you can push this to Heroku or whatever. How does it work? So the first step is to install the tools. So we have your typical Eclipse install dialog, and we have a set of tools here. So skip to this one. Then you need to create an SKS project. So you need to give it a name, and you need to specify the domain for the project. The intention behind this domain is to help the semantic bits of the SKS infrastructure help you find the matching web services. So for instance, if you have one domain which is a financial, then transactions means something different than in a database domain. So the same word can have very different meanings in a different domain. So that's why we need this domain parameter. Then you need to define the requirements. So as you can see here, it's going to be some plain English text. So one requirement could be that the client should be able to search for a product. So we want to have application that we can use to store database of products, and then for each of those products we want to be able to write reviews. So we could write something like 8 requirements that you see here, and we also added the ability for our users to log in with an account. So we also need to be able to create an account, and you can also specify all the properties for each of those objects. So for instance, we have an account that has an email, username, and a password. So this can all be described in plain English text. You can also draw some workflows. So this is what is described before. So it's a fairly simple graphical DSL language. So we can just, I think you'll know what to do here. And we can also import UML diagrams from images. So if, for instance, if you have some old Word document that has a new UML diagram inside, and you need to redraw it into your tools, so for instance into Papyrus, then you need to spend hours to actually redraw it. We have tools that can perform OCR on top of those images, and then just generate UML diagrams directly after the pictures. So for instance, if you take a picture like this and run it through our extractor, you'll get out a model. So it's not a picture anymore, it's a model, it can be edited. Of course, this is not perfect. It depends on the quality of the picture because OCR has its own limitations. So with respect to the UML diagram types, we support activity diagrams and use cases. So those are most common used to specify requirements. Okay, next step is when you have entered everything, you need to annotate all those requirements. And this can be done automatically for you. So we have an NLP service, that's a natural language processing service, that can parse English text and then extract parts of speech, so verbs and nouns and adjectives and so on. And then based on the training it received, it will also convert those into actors, actions, objects and properties, and their relations. So you can see here, so we have an actor is almost always the client, then we have an action to create something, which is an account, and account has properties of email, username, and password. So this works more or less okay, but of course this is dependent on the training of the NLP parser. So we trained our parser with a training set of 2,000 requirements, so we're now looking for more so that we can retrain it to achieve better accuracy and recall. So if it's not working perfectly, then you can always edit these requirements and then change any annotations, so you can delete any of those things and write new ones if the NLP bit got it wrong. Okay, then next step is usually to generate some code. So here we have some wizards that's going to help you describe the missing bits that are not in the requirements. So for instance, from the requirements we got some REST resources. So we have review, we have a product, we have an account, and we also added the search resource, which will be used to call the database search facility, and we also added the sentiment analysis, which is going to call an external web service that will tell us if the review was positive, neutral, or negative. So we can display a small smiling face if the product is nice. So for each of these, we need to define the CRUD activity. So that's basically mapping to your HTTP methods and the properties. So for instance, for the review, we have the text, title, and rating. And for each of those properties, we need to know the type. So this is also extracted from the requirements. So if you remember before, we had a statement that the client can read reviews. So this will map directly to the read method on a resource. And you can also have relations between resources. So I can state that, for instance, product can hold reviews, and I'll get a structure in my API. So I'll get reviews, product /one/reviews. So it has also those connections between resources. And of course, here you can add some specifics. If you want to add authorization there, then you can specify for which of those methods you want to have your client to be authorized. And we're also working on adding authorization. So that's a bit more work for the ABAC. So when you're done, you'll get out Maven project in Eclipse, something like this that has a lot of code generated for you and that you can compile and deploy and be done in more or less minutes. Okay, next step, if you want to have something more complex, then you need to define mashups. So that was an example that I had before. And we have a tool that is going to convert that diagram, find services that match to the words that you said there. So for instance, if I said get me a location of the client, it's going to call an API online to actually get the location based on the IP address of the caller, and then transfer the result into something else. So it's going to go to get IP, get location, get country, get a currency, and so on. So all the steps are connected automatically, and you have a tool that you can use to actually debug this workflow. So we can enter some parameters which are missing, and then see how it performs and which web services it's going to call, and the output results, and then generate this also as a Maven project. So you also get web service, and then you can integrate this web service into your other web services. So you can create mashups over mashups over mashups. And of course, with this, you'll also get some other nice features that I'll mention later. So you can see here we get also a Maven project that you can build. So it's not red because it's still compiling, and they're loading artifacts. And this will also be added into your Eclipse workspace. And then when you're done with all these steps, you can just compile and deploy and run it. So more or less that's it, but you need to write a client. So it's not going to be really directly usable. It's not meant to be used by humans because it's a REST web service. But you can write to yourself a client, so it can be a web application. So for instance, you're a startup that wants to quickly test your ideas, but you know that you need to have the front end look really nice, so you can develop that part yourself, and then use SKs just for quickly prototyping the backend API. So here we have REST reviews, which is a front end written in Angular, I think, for the web service that we generated before. And the service was done in 15 minutes, and the front end took, I think, a day or two. So we can have your own site with whatever you want that we support at this time, and have it done in minutes for the back end and days for the front end, depending on how good you are. And of course, you can also write a mobile application if you want to use it for that. So some limitations so far is that of course, in order to be able to find the web services, we need to have a catalog of web services. But the good thing is that if you're going to generate anything with SKs, it can automatically be registered in the same catalog. So you can offer your services to anybody else online to more or less reuse. So you could specify an API and conditions and maybe get some money out of it if it's really good. But of course, there's more. So you can always reuse the bits and pieces that are part of the platform. So you can use the NLP server that we have to analyze requirements and also to analyze free text in English that can form a query. So I can write a query, give me all the requirements that had anything to do with login, and you'll get back the query terms to look into your database. We also have some indexing engines which are also built based on pre-existing APIs from Marcos and Agora projects. So you can find on those APIs you can find indexes of SourceForge and some GitHub, I think, projects. So you can search for components that you might reuse in your application. So for instance, you need a JWT parsing library, so you can search for that, and Marcus will give you a result if it's available online, and index, of course. Then of course we plan to also expand this to have our own catalog of web services. So this will come in a few months, so around I think June. So we'll have a service catalog that can be used to find services which have been registered into SK's platform and also to publish your services. And we have the service annotation tool that you can use to add anything into SK's platform. So for instance, if you know a set of web services which seem to be nice and you want to use them, then you can use this tool to map a web service into a domain of the problem. So you can specify that it's, I don't know, a financial web service and what each of these service methods mean. We're also working on having some code metrics calculated. So what we want to have is to produce web services which are reliable. So we checked some code metrics, which is a debatable topic, I know, but some standards have been set by NASA and we are exceeding those. So the maintainability, readability, and perceived reliability of the code is better than NASA standards. So you should be able to also change anything you get out of SKs as a prototype, and then you can write it into a full-blown service. And we're also looking for anybody who's interested in expanding the platform. So it's built in Eclipse, it's meant to be extendable, so we are trying to find ways to make all the workflows expandable so that you can add your own tools and I don't know, stages in the workflow. And we also have a real nice feature of two-dimensional model-driven engineering. So MD is more or less your standard way of going through some steps between some really abstract specification like an ontology or a description of what I want to do, and then refining this to actually go into code. So it has a few typical steps, but we built on top of it to be able to extend those steps. So you can have a separate layer that's going to add authentication, then a separate layer that's going to add database search, and you don't need to work on everything at once. So you can just add as layers. So it's something that's otherwise really difficult in MDE. And that was used to actually build the functionalities that we have. So for authentication, authorization, and database search. We offer this in three types, so three offerings. We have Eclipse Solo, which is meant for trying out offline, more or less. So it's more or less for single developers who just want to see how it works, but have some small web services they want to develop, and they don't need to use anything that's available online. So they can annotate all the requirements manually. They don't need to use service composition, and that's okay for something simple. Then we have Eclipse Public, which is meant to be used by everybody else, more or less. So if you're a software company or a team or a freelancer and want to develop something quickly and want to use existing services, so you want to create mashups, then you need this because you also get access to the SKS infrastructure when we have an NLP service that's going to annotate the requirements for you and the service composition and everything else that I mentioned before. And if you're really big and want to have everything under your control, then you can also deploy this completely privately, so you can have this separately installed into your own cloud or whatever. So everything is free, it's all on GitHub, it's open source, so you can use it anytime. So if you want to see how it works, you can download it for GitHub from GitHub, and you can send me an email. I'd be happy to show you a demo at your own disposal whenever you like it, and we're also on Facebook, GitHub, LinkedIn, and Twitter, and we have two websites. So the top one is for the tools, and the bottom one is for the project. Do I have time? Okay. So how does it work? So I have a simple web service that says that I have some systems that have processes attached to it. So more or less. Or we can start from scratch if you want to yell some requirements. Any ideas? Okay. Then I have something like this. So I have a client that can create a system, can delete a system, can read systems. And each system has a host name and an IP address. And they also have processes which are attached to the system. So I can create processes on systems. I don't have internet connection, so I can't automatically annotate it for you, but this is done manually, so we can see that it's an editor that you can use, for instance, to change anything. So if this one was wrong, I can always add it as an object. And I can state, okay, so this action acts on a processes. Okay. So that's it. And I can also specify other workflows. So this is one simple workflow that I have that I've been mentioning all the time. Okay, so let's see how this works. So I have a project with just those two files, and I go into SKS dashboard, select the project. I need to reselect. We still have some bugs. Okay. So I have here buttons that going to open wizards to create requirements, to create storyboards, to create everything for you, but I just want to generate code. So it's going to pop up a wizard, and it says that, okay, I need to have some name for each of the resources. So for system, that can be a host name. It's strings are by default. And for processes, it can be a command. And I can also have relations. So let's see, system can hold a process. Okay, so this is it. Okay, finish. And it's generating code. So there you go.
And it's now compiling. Maybe I can run some Maven on top of that one. I don't see very well from here. Run as Maven build. Yeah, I just call package. Did I write it right? Okay, so let's do run. Okay. And then I have also my very own cloud, which is here. And I can deploy it. So let's call it. I've done this before, you can see. And deploy. And then we need to wait a few minutes. Ah, exit. Okay, I need to log in. See the screen just a sec to log in back. It's always going to be /API something, so I can just call the system, for instance, because that was defined. And let's see. It's demo time, so we never know. Okay, so I had something in the database, I think, or didn't. Linked list, so you'll get full third level richness and maturity of your web services, so everything that says that you should have links and you can also add basic authentication with the click of a button. Let's see if it works okay. So you can see here that we have links to all the properties and all the methods. It's not formatted really nice. So you can write a client without basically knowing anything about the service. So the structure of the service can be fetched by the client because it has all the links in the response. Let's see if Postman survived. Okay, in the meantime, do we have any questions? Well, I'm trying to click on this. Okay. Maybe. Okay. Okay. So this is what you get. You have the links to create a new system. So I did this before. So I have a database. It's a Postgres database that stores all the data. So you can also fetch it from other clients. And you can see that, for instance, if I go into system one, it's going to fetch the data for me. So you have the structure, you have the processes underneath it. I don't know if I created any, I don't think so. Maybe I did, okay, so we get the links for this. That was it for the demo, so it's not really nice because we need a client for that, but we have a sample online that you can see that's the REST reviews data web application that was created manually with an API that was generated with SKs. Any questions, perhaps? Yeah.
How do you map fields from your API to your backend service in case they are, for example, names or different type?
What do you mean from the API? The backend service is the API.
But forward your request to some backend service.
Ah, okay. Yeah, there's a wizard that you can use. So when you specify that you want to call external services, you have a wizard that can define complex types. So that's basically JSON type. So you can specify anything that's within JSON. Of course, it's a bit time consuming to map it if it's a huge structure, but we're also looking for ideas on how to improve that. So for instance, in the REST views, the call was get request with the query parameter. So that was simple. And then the response was a JSON object that's automatically parsed by this case. And in the second thing, if you have, for instance, your service composition, so you can let's say this one here, so you can take it into CD. So when you create a mashup, it's going to automatically do that for you. So it's going to map all the responses from the methods, and all the properties are going to be interconnected the best it can do. It will try to map all the things. So for instance, for this workflow here, where I have try to get the currency from the country and then get the exchange rate and then convert. So I got something like this. So you can see all the steps. And if I press play, but it's not going to work because I don't have internet properly configured. So if I do this, it's going to go through the steps, and then you can debug it and see what happens. So you can state some. Let's say I want to convert. 100, right number, yes, and Kuna. So these are going to be inputs to the workflow, and if I click play, it's going to go through all the steps, and then you can see what happens. And you can also generate the code from here, and it's going to be imported into Eclipse automatically.
So on one of the earlier slides, it said something about 2,000 lines of Java code
yes.
Zero bugs. So have you used any formal methods that would back up that claim? Because it's quite a bold claim.
Yes, when I wrote that, I wondered if anybody's going to notice. But yeah, right. the intent is that the generator code has been tested. So all the templates have been tested. So it's guaranteed to compile, and you also get a small test case. So we can't really state that it's going to be absolutely perfect, because it is possible that there are going to be some bugs. But the idea is that you're not writing any code manually. So all the known procedures are going to be written by the book from best practices. So that's the concept. So if you want to, for instance, add your own AMD layer to add, I don't know, something more complex on top of that, then you need to be careful with the templates, of course. But other than that, it shouldn't introduce any bugs which are not in the template. So all the process is tested and clean. So it goes through the models. So if it's not, the models should be correct themselves, because they have a very specific focus on the REST web services. I don't know if that's the answer, but yeah, we can discuss later on if you want. We have run everything through of course code quality analysis, and we're looking to calculate the reliability metrics of the services. So that's not really formal methods, but yeah. But you can run this on Java, what's it called, model checking VM if you want, and we can see how it works. Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
Samo bih htio reći da je ručak počeo, pa it's lunch time.
Thank you.